Thank you for joining Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and we will take you inside the auto industry like never before. And when I say we, I always mean my very, very knowledgeable and good-looking panelists located in the film strip below. Today we have another very exciting show. We have one of our panelists sitting in New York City to give us a report on the New York Auto Show. Yesterday and today were the media days, and on the day before that, or Wednesday, I guess, the 31st, they had some special forums. Mr. Warren Buffett was there, and I'm sure everybody wanted to know what he had to say. But before we get into that, a couple of things. Want to congratulate Ralph Giles, or Giles, depending upon how you pronounce it. I think it's Giles. Ralph was promoted to the head of design at Fiat Chrysler Automobile. And all of us know Ralph very well. We spent a lot of time with Ralph, and he is a tremendous, tremendous designer. So let's have the panelists introduce themselves, talk a little bit about who they are and where they are. And we'll have a conversation with our little vacationer, Mr. Heaps.
Hi, coming to you live from Greenville, South Carolina. I'm Russ Heaps. I've been covering the automotive industry for about 25, 30 years, somewhere in that vicinity. Done it for newspapers, magazines, and now several dot-coms. I'm also the editor of Greenville Insider, a deeper dive into Greenville. And I've taken a little break from a home remodeling project to join the panel today. And it's good to see you guys again.
Ron.
Hi, Ron Moorhead, coming from Northern California, and where it is nice and dry, unfortunately. Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Linda Sharp, and I'm coming to you from sort of overcast Mayberry, USA. Like Russ, I've been in this business for a lot of years. If I can borrow a line from my good friend Greg Morrison, I can say I'm executive producer of sharpdriver.com, which is a website that's about car reviews and NASCAR racing and sports car racing. I've had a syndicated newspaper column, and my husband lets me do this because I can't cook.
And Greg.
Hi, I'm Greg Morrison. I'm coming to you from New York City this week. Normally I'm in the dungeon in Atlanta, but I snuck out this week to come to the New York Auto Show for press days. I'm executive producer for Bumper to Bumper TV. We do weekly video vignettes on new car products and reviews and industry trends. And I'm looking forward to this, and I'm so, so glad to see Russ back with us. We've missed you, buddy.
Thanks. Rainbow sunshine in his yellow shirt.
Thanks. Yeah. And Greg, do they rent that room by the day or by the hour?
Yours is next door. That's one by the hour.
Yeah, we were in the green room talking about Russ, and all of a sudden he appeared, so we really had to be quiet. Well, good to see you back, man. You're looking good. Hope you're feeling good.
I'm feeling great. Actually, I had a cardiac wellness test this week, and the scores run from 0 to 400, with 0 being the best and 400 being, oh my God, I'm dead. And I scored a 0.
Hey,
they found a heart.
Good for you.
Yeah.
Good for you.
That's wonderful news.
All that micro brewing beer that you've been drinking is paid off.
Wine and good bourbon. I'm telling you, it's the secret.
I'm gonna start drinking.
Hey, some of us never stopped. But anyway, let me ask you all. How many of you use Twitter?
I do. In fact, I sent several tweets out from here in New York from various pictures of events. I'm not on it 24/7 like some people I know, but it's a useful tool. It is not the be-all and end-all.
Well, I just mentioned it because, you know, I kind of keep my eye on technology as much as I can. There's so much stuff going on. But recently there have been two software programs that you can use on your smartphone. One is called Meerkat, where literally you can download the free app, sign in to your Twitter account, and you can tweet live video streams to Meerkat. So, Greg, while you were walking around the show, rather than typing out a tweet, you could have fired up the old smartphone, went on Meerkat, and did some quick broadcast live, and people that are following you will get notified just like they do when you post a tweet that it's live, and you can interact with them. They can actually type in comments and you can respond. Now, with Meerkat, the live stream disappears once you disconnect, so you really have to have people who are waiting to see what you're doing for it to work to be effective. It's not recorded like a traditional tweet is. The other one is one called Periscope, and Periscope is the one that I like. Again, it's for Twitter. It's basically the same as Meerkat, but it's a little more sophisticated. You have a live stream, you download the Periscope app, sign up again to your Twitter account, and you can use your smartphone or I think an iPad, and you can literally tweet a live stream and again have people participating so you can interact. But that one is recorded for 24 hours. So at least it can be up there for a while for other people to look at it and retweet it and, you know, send it around like they normally do. But I found those two software packages to be extremely interesting. And the fact that they're free, but more importantly, you're live streaming. I mean, it's not like an hour ago you did this and posted a video. Now it's real time. I find that it's like what we're doing now. I just find that kind of technology is just unbelievable.
There were some people doing that here in the show. They were so busy looking down at the handheld screens, kept bumping into walls and each other.
Well, they do that in New York just walking down the street now. Everybody's like this.
Boink, boink, boink. Yeah.
And that's truly anti-social media.
Yep. Well, the live stream is social because just like we're sitting here now, we're face-to-face talking to each other. It's not like, you know, if you raise your hand, I can see you raise your hand. So, and if you laugh, I can see you laugh, and I can respond to the laugh if I choose to.
But Russ can't share his bourbon with us.
Well, no, that's coming.
Hey, leave Russ's bourbon alone. In fact, I'll have you know that Infinity had some very fine bourbons here for us to sample, and Russ, I made sure I did quality control for you with a couple shots of Bullet.
Excellent.
Well, we're going to go into have Greg to talk a little bit about the New York Auto Show, and I'll just open it with saying a couple of things. One, GM's president, Dan Ammann, was the keynote speaker for the first press day. It's at the breakfast. They normally have a keynote speaker. And the day before, like I said, they had Warren Buffett and Johan Dennison to speak at the Automotive Forum. So I'm sure that was an interesting thing. I don't know whether, Greg, did you go to the Automotive Forum? But I know you probably went to the breakfast, right?
I went to the breakfast. I didn't go to the forums. I didn't get in until too late on Tuesday. But what's interesting about the breakfast, Dan Ammann was talking about General Motors and especially the Chevy brand and how it's coming up with new models, high mileage models, which leads us into our first car, the Chevy Malibu. Chevy made a big deal of the Malibu reveal. We're talking not just about a sedan, but also a hybrid version. They're bringing back a hybrid in Malibu that will get 48 miles to the gallon combined.
Yeah, let me stop you right there because I know you sent me some shots and I did put them in a slideshow, so I want to have you to go through those before.
Sure.
And that way you can talk about each one. But I have a couple of questions. You mentioned hybrid, and that was one of my in the news things for the New York Auto Show. Was the New York Auto Show pretty much an all hybrid show or close to being all hybrid?
No. In fact, the two big hybrids were the Malibu hybrid and the the Toyota RAV4 hybrid. Everyone else pretty much talked about conventional platforms and conventional fuel systems. But everyone is offering mid-sized cars that are longer, wider, and in some cases a little taller or a little shorter than their predecessors. So the mid-size segment is getting bigger, much like a football player at the training table.
In the slide you sent me, you didn't send one of the Continental, and Linda and I were talking about that in the green room, and I like the Continental as well as the new Buick, what do they call it, the Avenir or Avenir, I don't know how you pronounce it.
Buick Avenir, which they showed in Detroit.
What do you think about those two cars?
The Continental is gorgeous. General Motors will tell you it's a beautiful concept. We may or may not make it, wink, wink, translation, they're going to build it. But they're primarily looking at the market in China for this vehicle, where there's a big demand for full-size luxury platforms. The Buick Avenir was an experiment, but again, something that would do very well in China, where there's a growing demand for full-size luxury automobiles by the growing middle class and upper class in China. When you get up close to the Continental, it's like, oh my God, someone actually thought of building a U.S.-designed supercar that we've talked about the need for how many months now among ourselves. The Continental is very, very impressive. The back seat, oh my God, all kinds of room. But just overall styling. And it was interesting because Lincoln had their stand right next to the Infiniti stand. And the folks from Infiniti were walking over taking a real hard look at that Continental and taking notes because, remember, they've got their Q60 long wheelbase out there now that's also going to the same market. And it was just an interesting series of events with each luxury maker trying to outdo each other because it's like, we're here to play with the big boys now. Rolls-Royce had an event with the Wraith, you know, the ultimate Rolls-Royce sedan and convertible. Again, a gorgeous vehicle, not very practical for most of us here in the U.S. Well, Russ could use it to go to Home Depot, I said, on second thought.
While I'm queuing up the slideshow, I know Ron Moorhead has some breaking news that he wants to share with us. Ron, what is it you were talking about?
Well, this happened at the New York show. I was not. Greg, I don't know whether you made it to the Honda little round table that they did, but John Mendel, who's a executive vice president, basically called Nissan out for their numbers, that they were using fleet numbers and kind of using them inappropriately. But basically what he said was, it's BS, and he didn't use the initials. He said,
no, he did not. It was one of those off-the-ropes type deal.
Yep, and he said, I'm tired of hearing about Nissan. And he kind of threw it out like, Honda is just really ready to go after Nissan in the sense that they're going to fight till the last bell rings, I guess, something like that.
Well, they're getting ready to set up a death cage over there at the Javits Center so that the executives can really duke it out. But it'll be a death cage with pens and accountants more than anything. It is ironic or perhaps interesting that the New York Auto Show also occurred on the first of the month when sales numbers come out. And what's the old axiom? Figures don't lie, but liars have been known to figure. So people are adjusting their sales numbers and playing with it and trying to put the best spin on it. Best overall news I can give you is it looks like we're on track for a 17 million unit year. Now the question is, are those numbers fleet numbers? Are they individual sales and so forth? And it is, there's a battle. There's a battle for that middle class, mid-sized buyer that everyone wants to be the king of because those are the folks who are writing the check every month, buying the units and moving the metal off the lot.
Yeah, and Nissan is kicking Honda's butt in a way.
Yeah, Nissan's doing very well. They're encroaching heavily in the midsize segment with the Altima, and then like things like the Rogue are doing very well. In fact, the reality of it is the Rogue got out there first, so Honda was forced to come up with the HR-V, that small urban-sized SUV-type vehicle, which every manufacturer is trying to come up with to compete and address the market of millennials who are becoming increasingly city dwellers, but still need a vehicle to load stuff in so when they go trekking on the weekends or whatever they want to do, they have something to carry things in. So,
the first ones to borrow their vehicle.
Yeah. You know, it's so you walk back and forth across the show and you hear multiple versions of the truth, at least from, you know, depends on who you're asking that day.
Well, one thing you said that really struck me, Greg, that I think is a commentary on the times is that the manufacturers are gravitating towards building luxury cars for China, but they're gravitating towards building sort of like easy fit jeans, if you would, with the midsize for the American market. Does that not tell us something about the economies of the two different markets?
Hey, no argument. China's the biggest economy in the world. Let's be honest about that. You know, we're buying, they're making. And right now, they're buying like mad. They're buying everything and anything. Because think about it. We've got a country that for 60 years is under communist rule, you know, no free enterprise, and all of a sudden it's the wild, wild west there. So, yeah, they're primed and ready for luxury platforms. Traditionally, Mercedes, BMW, Audi have been strong over there. Lexus has been strong over there. Until they get into a piss and match with the Japanese over various and sundry things. So there's a market there for these big, full-size luxury cars, well-appointed, and it's a status symbol in China. And speaking of status symbols, I see Roosevelt's put up a picture of the Golf Alltrack.
Yeah, you can take your time in talking about these because it's in a slideshow format, and I think they'll stay posted for about 20 seconds. So.
Okay. And that's your left. VW Beetle right there. Beetle's edition.
Well, I'm gonna bear with me, I'm gonna go back to the first one because you all were talking and it came up. Go ahead, Greg, talk about this one.
This is the Golf Alltrack. VW has taken that Golf platform, which has been extremely successful, made a wagon out of it, all-wheel drive, four motion, very familiar technology. It's called the Alltrack. It sits up a little higher than the regular Golfs, and they think there's a market. And again, they've done multiple variations on the Beetle platform, the denim edition. They have a pink edition for those who want it. They even showed a hybrid VW Beetle this year. So Volkswagen is trying to be a little bit of everything to everyone right now. There were no brand new cars other than the Golf at the show, but they're working with it. And this is the Malibu that I was telling you about. Mark Royce was like a proud parent showing off this new Malibu, which is longer, it's wider, it's got more horsepower. It's 200 pounds lighter than its predecessor. Better fuel economy. They have a hybrid edition that he was also extremely proud of. Ed Welburn sitting in the corner like a Chessie cat, grinning because he knows they've done another one. So it's been a good week for General Motors at the auto shows.
Now let's take a minute and talk a little bit more about the Malibu. The Malibu has gotten a lot of press lately, and I am really impressed if these numbers hold up with the mileage numbers. You're talking about, what, 48 miles per gallon?
For mid-size hybrid.
Yeah, and how many in the city? Is it 45 or 47 miles per gallon in the city, something like that? Some ridiculous numbers.
I'm sorry, 48 highway, 45 city, combined 47.
Is the hybrid a true hybrid, or is it a mild hybrid like the last one was?
This is a true hybrid. And they're quite pleased with it. The weight reductions are the real big thing here. And the technology and data platforms that this thing can work with are very impressive because this is the kind of stuff that a few years ago we would have only associated with luxury brands like Buick or Cadillac, something like that. But they're bringing it down to, you know, the midsize segment and below.
Now, I think this car might make the electric, all-electric car manufacturers rethink them, you know, rethink the mileage situation, because if you're getting 48 miles per gallon, and yeah, you're using petrol, but still, those are some big numbers, especially the city numbers.
Did they say anything about pricing, Greg?
No, they did not release pricing information. And that's always going to be the big question. What's the number? What's the ask? But they're very, very proud of this because this is letting them play against, they admit it, Toyota and Honda have dominated the midsize hybrid platform segment. Here's the Continental.
Oh, we did have a Continental in there.
Is that gorgeous or what?
Yep, I like those wheels.
The wheels, the door handles such that you just gently touch them and the door opens. Just really attention to a lot of detail, aim for the Chinese market. And I want one of these delivered to the house.
Oh, this is one I want.
Me three.
Porsche Boxster Spider. Is that gorgeous or what? And so, oh, by the way, the option is air conditioning and a radio.
Now, is that a soft top or a hard top?
It's a soft top. A hard top option is available. Would you believe this is a Scion sedan? Meet the Scion IA. Four-door sedan in the Scion group. Interesting styling. Very great departure from the traditional box that we associate with Scion. Trying to keep the Scion owners happy with something refreshed and different because, you know, the brands needed something new. This is the IM, a five-door coupe, a five-door vehicle from Scion with a sportier edge. Again, trying to keep those buyers interested and energized about the brand. Looks more like a production vehicle that you put out there. Oh, I'm sorry, no, I couldn't see this at first. That's the Subaru. That's the Subaru WRX STI. And here's Honda's Civic Concept. This is what the new Honda Civic will look like. What do you think, guys?
Much better.
Yeah, looks good. Looks good.
Looks street ready.
Oh, yeah, it is. It's ready to go. You know how Honda says it's a concept? Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. This is going into production. This is the Mazda Miata or MX-5, the new version. When you get up close and see the lines, it is just fluid and gorgeous. And they've loaded it up with all kinds of things like lane departure warning systems. They put a screen system in this so you can have a screen with a display screen and so forth. And it's still very much fun.
Can we go back to that for a moment? Look at those big shoulders of those rear fenders on that.
Yeah, MX-5. Isn't it gorgeous? Roosevelt, can we go back to that? Yeah, there.
Yeah. Look at that.
Doesn't that call to mind some of the really classic Jaguar bodies of the past? I mean, it's so elegant looking, really pretty.
The lines are gorgeous.
Greg, do they still introduce it as a Miata, or have they dropped Miata and just call it MX-5?
MX-5.
They just announced the base price for that too, which is under $25,000, which is pretty good.
Holy moly!
Infiniti's said they're actually going to build a car or a truck, the QX60, which they were very proud of the restyle on. Basically, this is the old EX platform with a bigger engine and stretched out. And for Infiniti, that's something they desperately, desperately needed. It was just one of those.
Let's go back to the slideshow.
I thought I sent you some others. What about the Murano and the other stuff I sent you?
I don't remember seeing a Murano.
I sent it to you this morning.
I guess I didn't. I'm sorry I didn't put it in. I didn't get it. I apologize. But you can talk about it.
Nissan's Murano. They finally have a four-door sports car. They've updated it. The floating roofline. Great looks. The V front end. You can see it's very much related to the GTR. Carlos Ghosn was like, yeah, look at what I get. Look what my folks can make. And flexing and showing off with this vehicle.
Hey, Greg.
Yes, sir.
Did you get a chance to look at the Maxima?
Yes.
What do you think
of that? I meant Maxima, not Murano. The Maxima is what they rolled out here.
The Maxima. Okay. Yeah.
And it's a good-looking vehicle. They took a lot of time to really do some nice things with it. Again, a weight loss, longer, wider, much more impressive platform on the road. And I think people will be extremely, extremely happy with what they see. It makes people, you know, I know a number of people, when you say Maxima, someone said to me, do they still make those? But this one will make you remember, oh, yeah, they're making this.
It's an underrated vehicle for Nissan, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Remember, their original tagline was the four-door sports car.
Sports car.
Yeah. And they just brought up and...
Yep. One of my favorites.
That was one of the crowd pleasers. Cadillac, of course, showed off the CTS here in New York, the CTS6, which is they're going to be their flagship platform. And your friend Johan was in his glory, as you know, with Cadillac now headquartered in New York and doing things here, because he sees this as a way to make Cadillac a world brand with a full-size sedan with very good lines, performance potential, plenty of available room to stretch out in. Again, with an eye toward the Chinese market, but also there is a demand in Europe and North America for a full-size luxury sedan. So why not do it right? And they're getting there.
The CT6 going to be their top-of-the-line?
Yes, they're top-of-the-line. They're going to retire a lot of the older names there, but they haven't retired them. And he's talking about 3 to 4 new vehicles and rebranding within the next 5 years. for the Cadillac nameplate. You know, and for
those
who
in production that, when? Or is it in production now?
CTS6 goes into production, I believe it's August.
So it's a 2016 model
yeah,
coming out.
Yeah, it's a 16 model, yeah.
Now, you were briefly talking about the Maxima, and I just read an article where Maxima will have what's called the driver attention alert, which means on the dash, well, in the center of the gauges will be an icon of a coffee cup. And the purpose of the coffee cup is if you start getting drowsy or starting to veer off the road, the coffee cup will start, I guess, to shake, and you will also get an audible sound which tells you, hey, you need to pull over and take a nap or something.
But that's not new technology.
That's one of the new technologies that they're going to have in the Maxima, and from what I understand, they're going to move it across other product lines.
But that's also, Volvo tried that a few years ago, a similar type thing, so did Mercedes. What Nissan has done is taken it to the next level, and just instead of a warning like to say, you're getting drowsy, the audible alert, the idea that making the driver more in tune with what's going on around him, because let's face it, with all the technology in cars, you can get into a car, almost put it on autopilot. I know that's a dirty word to Linda. And the car sort of drives itself. And this way you actually have to be more engaged with what you're doing behind the wheel of a car. And I think all of us will agree that is critically important. We've seen so many folks who've lost their minds because they're so busy listening to music or paying attention to social media, they're not paying attention to their driving.
Has anyone other than me experienced one of these where it tells you that you're getting drowsy and it's just because you've changed lanes two or three times in a short distance? I've had that happen. I wasn't asleep. I was just changing lanes, going through traffic, and it was telling me I was getting drowsy, getting out of my lane too much.
I guess you weren't using your turn signals, Linda.
Remember turn signals that stick on the left?
Yeah, not the shifter. I know it's not down there where you shift.
If you use a turn signal in Atlanta traffic, you'll never get that spot because they'll go, oh, close that up right now.
Okay, tell your insurance company that.
I'm not driving my own personal vehicle.
Yeah, I wonder. You know, I wonder if the Maxima alert will override what Linda was just mentioning, the lane departure, if you don't use the turn signal. Or would you get two warnings, two different types of warnings?
And it's interesting because they talk about that, and then Honda, Ron mentioned earlier about the smackdown, so to speak, between Honda and Nissan. Honda showed off some technology, again, a driver alert, driver awareness technology, that they're offering as a test to sort of feel the waters out, especially for the CRV and HRV platforms that are speaking to some of the same issues. And we've all talked about emerging technology, what's going to come next. Apparently, this is it. Someone realized we've got to do more than entertain the driver. We've really got to keep them paying attention to what's going on behind the wheel, what's going on with the vehicle.
Now, Toyota and Lexus, since we were talking about technologies, they've decided to offer technology or safety packages ranging anywhere from $300 depending upon the model up to $635. And in the package you'll get something like automatic braking, lane departure, and pedestrian detection. And I've talked to quite a few people who see me driving cars, and once they sit in it and they see all the technology that some of the cars that we drive have that they don't have in their cars, and the first thing they want to know is how much does it cost for this, how much does it cost for that, and you start throwing around $600, $700, $800 numbers for some of this technology, people are turned off. So I guess Toyota and Lexus are taking advantage of the fact that people are always looking for a better deal, that they're going to package these different technologies.
Well, today Bill Fay, the senior general manager at Toyota, announced with the RAV4 that they will offer the combined safety suite package of lane detection, automatic braking, pedestrian detection, a round view camera for $500 as complete package. One-stop shopping, everything, as an option on the XL and limited models of the new RAV4. And then he announced that this will be available across all of the Toyota lines over the next 2 years, So no matter what product you buy from Toyota, you can get this as an option, one-stop shopping, rather than having to say, well, I have to do this, but I can't afford that. Because traditionally, we're talking, some of these features were $1,500, $1,200, so that number starts adding up after a while. That's like 2 to 3 years of extra payments. Okay. And, you know, so if for this kind of move, to bring the technology down to a much more affordable price of a $500 investment, it's a great business move.
Especially for a package.
I think one of the technologies, and yes, Roosevelt, I really like this technology. The rear view camera that gives you cross traffic alerts and things like that. I mean, I figure if it saves you one accident, it has paid for itself. It has more than paid for itself. Not only in your insurance premium, but in the aggravation factor. I think that what we're seeing on this technology deal is just like, you know, when they first came out with transistor radios, they were, you know, $1 million or, you know, or hand calculators. And, you know, and as it's become more and more commonplace, there has been trickle-down economics on technologies. And I think we're seeing that evolve into the auto industry at this time, that these things are getting more affordable as they come down the food chain, so to speak, to cars that real people can buy.
Yeah, I was backing out of a friend's driveway, and I don't remember the car I was in, but I looked at the camera on the nav screen, didn't see anything, but being as old as I am, I was always taught to turn my head and look as well. So I turned my head, looked left, and I looked right, and I was getting ready to back up again, and the car alarm went off. It started beeping, you know, beep, beep. I'm saying, what the heck's going on? Next thing you know, a car passes. It had picked up the car at a distance that was really out of my line of sight, which I found amazing.
And, you know, let's face it, how many of us have done the stupid like that and just barely escaped with a scary moment?
Yep.
Russ, I saw something that you would like. Had a conversation with some people from Toyota about fuel cells. They are going all in on hydrogen fuel cells, thinking that that'll be the way to make an electric car workable with range. And it's like, oh my God, Russ Heath should be loving this, because it's right in your wheelhouse.
You know, brilliant minds think alike. That's all I can say.
They, by the way, they asked for your address to send the check.
Ooh, I was thinking his intelligence is only exceeded by his modesty.
Right. Who has a fuel cell?
I love you, Russ. I do.
Russ, who has a fuel cell car on the street now?
The only company that really has one on the street is Hyundai. Has some Tucson's, not a lot, a few. There still may be an Equinox, a Chevy Equinox fuel cell rolling around from the program that they did 3 or 4 years ago, but that's not something they're actively doing anymore.
Are they in the hands of consumers or in the hands of, like...
In the hands of consumers.
Because I haven't heard anything about, you know, performance results or reliability or anything.
Greg, didn't they say at the Atlanta Auto Show that Toyota was going to have fuel cells in the showrooms in California? Was it in August?
Yeah, by August. But, of course, this is a $57,000 Mirai. That's the ask point for the vehicle right now. Once you start factoring in discounts, it brings it down to about, what, 43 or something like that. And the bigger question to me is, okay, where do I get hydrogen? And one of the things the Toyota reps were telling us were that they're finding that gas station operators are very excited about the idea of converting one of the traditional gasoline storage tanks to hydrogen, because hydrogen is a stable price factor because it comes from natural gas, which we have plenty of in this country, as opposed to gasoline, which is subject to the vagaries of whatever OPEC wants to do that week. So it's got to get interesting. It's a great discussion that's going on.
The program Hyundai has going here in California is they're leasing them to customers in areas where there are the infrastructure in Southern California, Sacramento, those areas. And from what I understand, they've quite successful. People love the vehicles, but I haven't seen any testing back out. I've been trying to get one.
What's the range on a tank?
About 300 miles.
That's what I heard. Yeah.
Which is not bad.
And we still don't have any idea cost figure, right?
Hydrogen right now prices out about the same as regular unleaded, even though it's measured differently for the, basically for the amount to get the 300-mile range that Russ is talking about, will cost you about the same, about $2.30 a gallon, or the equivalent of a gallon of hydrogen. And the good news is what comes out the back end of the car is water. So you don't have to do emissions tests.
No emissions, yeah.
Well, there's your water need in California.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a win-win. It's a fuel cells, I'm telling you. Win-win-win-win.
All the drivers in California need to drive hydrogen cars, hydrogen fuel cell cars. You know,
next time I see our governor, I'll let him know that.
They'll be driving up and down between the rows of lettuce.
Yeah, know? Right.
Hey, but look at it this way. All you need is natural gas to create hydrogen. You think there's enough hot air in California for that?
Yeah.
All in Sacramento. Yeah.
Now, overall, other than the fact that you have to put petrol in the car, the Malibu still seems like the best buy.
They're bringing it. And Hyundai will be coming out very soon with a new hybrid version of the Sonata. Kia will be coming out very soon with a new hybrid version of the Optima. So, I mean, the midsize segment, a hybrid that works, that gets good fuel numbers like in the 40s, that's a very achievable goal these days. It's ironic, Mercedes-Benz, which sort of played around with the hybrid, hasn't really done a whole lot with it in terms of promoting that platform, at least for U.S. and North American consumption. I can't figure it out. Does anybody understand that? Does anybody ever understand Mercedes?
Mercedes marches to their own drumbeat.
Yeah.
I think the major issue with Malibu, and it's an issue that Chevy has with Malibu now. Malibu's a good car. The current Malibu is a pretty good car. The problem is when you compare it, its content to its competitors, it's a little expensive. And they need to figure out some way to get that price down to make it a little more competitive. It costs more than the Altima, similarly contented Altima. It costs more than a similarly contented Camry. So they kind of need to get the price under control a little bit.
Yeah, and I think they recognize
it's still lower than the hybrids.
Price well, level. Yeah. The current one,
remember when Ford, I don't know if they still do it, but they sold the Taurus, the hybrid or the non-hybrid, for the same price. You didn't pay a premium for the hybrid. I'm surprised that more manufacturers haven't moved to that, you know, phase of, you know, offering your choice, either or, at the same price.
Do they still do that?
I don't know if they still do or not, but they did for quite a while.
Yeah, Lincoln was doing that for a while.
And Buick. Buick was doing that, too.
Yeah. That sounds like what they do with leasing. Sometimes they'll have leasing where you can just drive the car. There's no deposit, no first payment, no security deposit. So
they must do that every now and then.
Marisa, you were talking about how impressed you were with the Malibu numbers, and I myself am very impressed with them. But I have to go back to the, I believe, didn't the current generation of Bug come out in the late 90s? When the redesigned Bug. Wasn't it the late 90s?
Well, they sort of changed it. They did a fairly major workover on the Bug convertible. I mean, the Bug body.
When they brought it back, I had a friend that had a diesel Bug, okay? And I think it was like a 98 or a 99 model, okay? And she regularly got 52, 53 miles per gallon. I had another friend that had a diesel Jetta that swears he got 60 miles per gallon on a trip from Ohio to Florida. Now, I realize that they have done a lot of things to these cars, added weight to them and added restrictions and this, that, and the other. But there have been cars in the past, diesels, that have got numbers that are comparable to these or better. So,
Yeah.
The only people that seems to be investing in diesel with any focus is Audi.
Well, consumers always take the path of least resistance. And when you mention diesels, everybody seems to go back to the old diesel days. And I don't know how some of the younger people even know about the old diesel days unless it comes from us, and we keep talking about it.
Well, now the GM diesels from the 80s, they were a disaster.
Oh, yeah, I mean, those were the old, but I'm talking about the new diesels now. You can't compare them to the diesels of 4 or 5 years ago. It's just the technology.
I still want to drive a Mini Cooper turbo diesel. I still want to drive one of those, and they only sell them in Europe. Or I guess they sell them in Canada.
I think the Malibu will do well because, again, it's the path of least resistance. It's not a hybrid. It's not a diesel. It's traditional gasoline, and it gets high gas mileage.
Yeah, we're talking.
And that's what people look for.
They're talking two versions of the Malibu. One with a smaller block economy engine that looks a 1.6-liter Ecotec. That's going to be 37 miles to the gallon highway. So you go into hybrid country, which is like 47 to the gallon open road, you're playing in some pretty tall cotton over there in terms of mileage numbers. The issue, as you say, is getting people to adopt and accept this technology. Now, every one of us on this panel remembers when Toyota first rolled out the first hybrid in this country, we were all scared as long-tailed cats in a room full of rocking chairs just to drive one on a ride and ride for fear we'd run out of fuel and the thing wouldn't get us back to our destination.
Yep.
I love that, long-tailed cats in a room full of rocking chairs. That's a really good one there, Greg.
And I think last week I quoted some numbers. I think it was a report, maybe it was J.D. Powers or somebody did a report, that the average adult drives 25.6 miles daily, or 27.6, which is way less than any of the hybrids will do or the all-electrics will do. I mean, so you could drive those cars and feel very comfortable about getting back home.
Yeah.
I mean, it's acceptance of the technology. I think the other thing, and we've talked about it time and time again, is the infrastructure. I think if there was more media attention to infrastructure and how fast these charging stations and the fast charging stations are going up and who's talking about installing the hydrogen, you know, refueling stations, I think you'll have the public buying more of these products. But if they feel that they can't get a charge or they can't get get hydrogen, they're not going to accept them. It's just that simple. Greg, talk a little bit about, did you attend the World Car Awards? I have the results here, but
I missed that this morning because I wanted to get my position, camera position at the Nissan Maxima reveal. I heard that the BMW i8 won Green Car of the Year. That's like craziness.
Say they have like five categories. Mercedes took four or five. So it was a great show for Mercedes. So.
Yeah.
who
are the judges?
We want about Mercedes, but that's why those people get paid the big bucks. I mean, the World Car of the Year was Mercedes-Benz C-Class. The World Luxury Car was the Mercedes-Benz S-Class. The Performance Car was Mercedes-Benz AMG GT. And as Greg, the green car was the BMW i8, and the World Car Design of the Year was this, what is it, Citroen C4 Cactus.
Now, when's the last time you saw a Citroen dealership in the U.S., let alone a Citroen?
Thank you.
They haven't had one for a long time.
Since Charles de Gaulle's president.
But, hey, they took a design award. But Mercedes... Is the GT even on the streets yet, the AMG GT? Is it out yet?
I saw one at the show in Atlanta, but I have not seen one on the streets.
Are they for sale yet, or does anybody know whether they're in dealerships?
I have no idea.
Who was on the panel that voted for these awards?
German magazine? I don't know.
Yeah, I wondered if all the voting took place in Stuttgart or something.
now.
Oh, I'm just asking.
Just asking.
Well, like I said, they took four out of five big categories. So you'll start seeing Mercedes-Benz TV commercials now with all these different awards across the screen.
Which, speaking of Mercedes, Roosevelt, did you see yesterday on the local news why North Carolina lost out on Mercedes-Benz headquarters moving to Georgia over North Carolina?
No, the only reason I can think of it was North Carolina, and North Carolina is not one of the most forward-thinking states that I've
been
in. Well,
it had something to do with the fact that we offered $15 million of incentives, or $115, and the state of Georgia offered $23 million or $123
million. You mean North Carolina offered $23 million?
No, North Carolina offered less.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Georgia offered more.
Offered how much?
I can't remember if it was $15 million or $115 million, or if it was $123 million or $23 million. But the variable was between 15 and 23, with 23 being the Georgia. And the other thing was the proximity to their plant in Alabama.
Right.
Just think of the words of Everett McKinley Dirksen, the former senator from Illinois. Million here, million there. After a while, you start talking about real money, folks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I was in front of I drove past the Mercedes plant in Vance a couple weeks ago and was just shocked at how large that campus has become. I think it has quadrupled in size. It's just enormous now.
Well, I haven't seen it in a while. I know here in North Carolina, the movie industry has pretty much packed up and moved out, because the legislature decided to drop the tax incentives for movies. So that didn't help Mercedes making their decision, you know.
Yeah. And now there's rumors that Volvo may be looking at North Carolina for possibly, what they say, they're going to spend $500 billion building a facility, Volvo is, in the U.S.?
That's huge.
Well, unless the legislature changes their attitude, Volvo will be looking, and they will be someplace else. They won't be in North Carolina.
Well, don't hold your breath for them to change your attitudes.
I mean, the movie industry was pumping, you know, millions and millions of dollars into the state. Unbelievable. And all of a sudden, they just decided, well, we don't, if they want to come here, they can come, but we're not going to give them any breaks anymore. So they packed up all their gear and went home. They went other places.
I think that sort of falls under the category of penny wise and pound foolish.
They didn't come back to California because California won't give them anything either. So.
Yeah.
Well, I find it interesting that Volvo wants to do a U.S. assembly plant, especially after just opening that facility in China a few years ago. Now they're talking about a U.S. assembly plant. They see a part of the market that is, so to speak, underserved. And if you're going to play in the North American market, you may as well build here. It's cheaper than shipping.
Well, I think what they see is those companies that have manufacturing plants in the U.S. are kicking their butt in sales in all the categories.
I mean, and technically, wouldn't it be the first Chinese car company in the U.S.?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. So, you know, it would come in with a good reputation, and I think it would probably go a long way to quell the concerns about it being, quote, Chinese-owned. Because most people wouldn't even pick up on the fact that it was Chinese-owned. Just like, you know, we go to Walmart and we buy everything in the world that's made in China.
Yeah, just look at the bottom.
But we don't pay it any attention.
Greg, was there any conversation among the journalists about Aston Martin and Fisker, Aston Martin says that Fisker has ripped off their design with this new Thunderbolt?
There was a little bit of talk about it, but you got to understand, the folks who cover the luxury segment are a small part of the automotive industry. And, you know, there's that back and forth, and you look at the vehicles, and yeah, you see a lot of resemblance and a lot of similarities. The question is okay, you stole my design and built a car around it. Now what are you going to do? Yes, you can go to court, but by the time you start running the billable hours up for lawyers on both sides, you could have gone ahead and built another model. So I see at some point that Aston Martin will get back at Fisker. How, I'm not sure, but it is worth watching. As someone once said, it's billionaires and millionaires fighting over stuff that the rest of us can't fathom.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if you look at the design,
building cars.
Go ahead. What'd you say, Russ?
I was just saying I didn't even realize Fisker was still building cars.
Well, they have one that they want to come out with that looks like the Aston Martin. So they may not get to build one of them. That may be the only one that they build.
I just, you know, they are such a little pimple on the rear end of the auto industry. I don't even, who cares?
Yeah, but when you're talking about design and trading and trademarks and copyrights and, you know, patent, design patents and all of that, you can produce a one-off, and if somebody hears about it and they think that you are infringing, you will be attacked. You will be caught. You will
I
be,
guess.
Yeah.
Remember the fight between, was it Hummer and Jeep about the grill?
The grill.
Yeah.
Well, that was, you know, that was two, Jeep, a huge player, and Hummer, one that was an up-and-comer at the time, but Fisker, geez, oh, Pete. I'm not being facetious. I thought they were out of business. I didn't even realize they were still a viable outfit.
Yeah, they had gone through a lot of financial issues, that's for sure.
Right.
Maybe they just call it Aston Martin Light or Aston Martin Electric.
Now, Greg, Jaguar had a big promotion where they had an XF, I don't know whether any of you saw it, driving across these two wires across some water outside of London. It was a stunt to show. I don't know what they were trying to show, but it's like it was a high wire act with an XF.
The Automotive Willindas, maybe?
And you could, yeah, that's what it looked like. And they had so much stuff attached to that car. I mean, I think any car could have performed the feat, but I don't know whether I guess they did it for sensationalism or what, but was that even, were there any video of that at the Jaguar
stand? They showed a little bit of that at the presentation of the XF aluminum, I can't even say it the way the Brits do, all aluminum body.
Aluminum.
Which they're very proud of. It's a lightweight version of the XF sedan. It's beautiful. The lines on it are like, oh, my heart be still. That was one of the press conferences I had to do a hopscotch around. But I came back and looked at the car, and it's just absolutely.
But did they mention the act that was performed with the car?
They showed the video at the
presentation.
Oh, did they?
Okay.
Yeah. And I just, you know, I couldn't be at every place all the time, but it was very impressive to see. And I think it's a great stunt on their part. And I will give the new owners of the Jaguar Land Rover Group credit for being willing to go out on the edge and do some crazy promotional stuff to get people to pay attention to these luxury brands. And, of course, Land Rover came up with the Autobiography SV version, which is the uber luxury Land Rover that you can climb a mountain with and still have an executive in the back seat working on his spreadsheets. Very, you know, really over the top in terms of luxury. And that's a brand that, if I'm Mercedes, I would be very concerned about what Land Rover is doing in terms of luxury SUVs, because they can match up against Mercedes and all the other makers. In fact, they're setting the standard for everybody in that segment right now.
What did Mercedes have to say about their concept truck that they say it's a concept, but it's going to be built?
They did the usual dance around it that, you know, we're really considering this. I think they have an idea, but really, a Mercedes truck, unless you're talking about a heavy-duty diesel or delivery truck, I just don't see a market for a Mercedes pickup, at least not in the North American segment, not when you get Ford, General Motors, Fiat Chrysler, Nissan, and Toyota all playing in that segment already.
But from what I've been reading, all the different articles, if the articles are true, it looks like it may happen. It's a good looking truck from the, you know, from the design.
Good looking truck. But, you know, sometimes Mercedes, you know, will stub their toe, and we've seen that happen a few times. You know, remember the first C-Class?
Yep.
You know, sometimes there's certain things you just don't do. You know, and one of them would be for Mercedes trying to build a pickup truck in that segment that is dominated by the domestic nameplates that have learned the hard way how to do it and have very loyal buyers.
So
or like
what,
me trying to be a landscaper like Russ is. I mean, I just don't have the skill set.
What kind of what manufacturer surprised you?
Um, overall, I would say Portia, that spider, you saw that. That was just so beautiful. That was the thing that just got your heart going pitter-patter. They just did a great job with that. The other one that got my attention for the technology level is Chevy with the Spark. You know, this is the opposite end of the scale. This small urban vehicle, the mini cars, put a lot of technology into this vehicle, and they're willing to fight tooth and nail for that segment, the mini car, the urban car, that there's a market that they want to try to become a player in, because these things have done very well overseas, and they're starting to make inroads here in the North American market.
Now, did the manufacturers, since they've been doing so well, did they go back to having the elaborate displays, elaborate stands?
Not really, because it's tight in there. You have Kia and Hyundai had fairly sizable displays. Chevy's was a small space. Cadillac's was a small space. Buick had an even smaller space. The big, wide open things, there are too many manufacturers for the space in Javits right now that have big, elaborate displays. And, you know, that tells me something interesting, that it's not just the big three and the Germans anymore. It is, what, the big eight, the big ten? We need a commissioner. Ron, are you up for the job?
Well, why don't we go into, it's getting close to the witching hour, as we say here. Let's go to our first thoughts car of the day. This is the 2015 Chrysler 200C, yours truly sitting behind the wheel using Google Glass to talk a little bit about it. It has a 3.6-liter V6 that delivers 295 horsepower at 262 pound-feet of torque. Has a 9-speed automatic transmission. Exterior color is a lunar white tri-coat pearl. Interior is black. 19 miles per gallon city, 32 highway, 23 combined. This model has an MSRP of $35,285. First thoughts, Russ?
I think with the 200, Chrysler has created really a world-class car, much, much better than the Sebring. It's a much better looking car. They've put a lot of effort into the styling, both inside and out. It's competitive in pretty much every category. I like it a lot.
Ron?
I really like the design that Chrysler's gone here. I think it's a very attractive car. It's certainly fits well with the rest of the sedans in this category. I have issue with my drives with the vehicle. It's not smooth. The transmission is jerky. The software is not right with the engine. They need to rework some things there. But other than that, I don't think it's a world car yet. I think it's possible. It's certainly better than the Sebring. I think they're on the right track.
Linda?
Well, I would second everybody's statements that it's a lovely car to look at. Like, in certain angles, the profile really draw to mind some much higher priced luxury cars. I think that they've come a long way in stepping up their program to attract buyers over what the Sebring did. I haven't driven this particular car, but I would think with a 9-speed transmission that it should pretty much keep the engine in the power band all the time, which should be a plus, and I would think would make the fuel economy a little bit better than what you said that it was. But that said, it is a very pretty car, very pretty package, and I think they should be applauded for moving in the right direction.
Greg?
Thank you. God, someone drove a stake in the heart of the Sebring. God, that was
bad. That's what you really think.
Design, I agree. The lines are very impressive. Fit and finish looks to be much better than the Sebring. I am looking forward to getting my hands on this and driving it. I am concerned, though, if you get a 9-speed gearbox that has all this capability and it's not matching up right, because the algorithms on the software aren't quite right. Somebody needs to go back to the drawing board. But that's a fixable thing. And Chrysler is Fiat Chrysler is working hard to become a respected brand again. I would not be surprised if we see somewhere down the line some of this technology and approaches that they're using with this and the current 300 to come up with another full-size Uber luxury platform from this brand that'll make us all say, what in the heck is that? But they're going down the right road. Again, let's get this algorithms and the logic on the transmission straightened out. It could be a really good platform for the brand, bring people in who normally wouldn't even look at Chrysler.
Well, I tell you, when I heard I was getting this 200C, the first thing I thought about was, okay, how many rattles and squeaks is this thing going to have? You know, because like everybody said, it's a throwback to your thoughts of the Sebring. And this is light years beyond. This will make anybody forget about the Sebring. I was amazed at the steering, the handling. The car felt like it was a heavyweight. The steering wheel felt like you know, the car was substantial. I was impressed with the interior. And I truly do like the lines of the car. They did a great job on the design. But when you get behind the wheel of this car, it's like you're driving one of the bigger, lower-priced German cars when it comes to the handling and the steering. So, Ron, I guess we disagree a little bit a little bit on that. But I know you love your Porsche, so. But anyway, I want to thank you all for taking the time to tune into Auto Network Reports. I want to thank the panelists for, again, giving an hour of their time to sit here and talk about our favorite market, the auto industry. Look forward to seeing you next Thursday, same time, same station. And as always, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. See you next time.
Take care.
Adios.
Happy Easter, y'all. Don't eat too many boiled eggs.